All right, good afternoon, everyone. How are you today? Good. What's going on? Everybody's on this side of the room today instead of in the middle, like normal. Decided after spring break you're going to have a new location? Okay. Well, again, I want to welcome each and every one of you guys to CareerWise Wednesday. We're really excited about today's topic. As you registered, if you hadn't pre-registered, we'll get you a StrengthsQuest code, or you received one. So after today's lesson, if you'll take that assessment, it does take about 45 minutes to complete. So make sure that you have that time to do so. And Amy's presentation will make a lot more sense after you have your results. I do want to welcome the Easton Center Advisory Board. We've got some special guests with us today. And they'll be joining us, so thanks for being here, guys. And I would like to introduce our speaker for today. So Ms. Amy Gasaway is a Student Success Coordinator in the College of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources. She's also certified by Gallup in StrengthsQuest Education, and the College of Ag Sciences and Natural Resources uses StrengthsQuest with all of their new students. So she's an expert in this area, and like I said, I think you'll really enjoy her topic for today. So let's welcome Amy.
Thank you very much. Appreciate you all being here today. I am not a real formal, formal person by any means. So feel free to call me Amy. I hope that this can be a little bit interactive. If you have questions as we go through, please don't hesitate to ask. Strengths is something I'm very passionate about. I've been a strengths advocate on this campus since 2008. That's when we first started using the Clifton Strengths Finder with our freshmen in the College of Ag Sciences and Natural Resources, and also started using it with leadership development with our CASNR student success leaders. I am so passionate about strengths that it is also the subject of my dissertation. I'm a part-time PhD student as well, and currently doing research on the Strengths Finder and its influence on academic success. So again, feel free to ask questions as we go throughout this afternoon. Since some of you have taken the StrengthsFinder, but some of you haven't, I'm going to share with you initially just some basics about the StrengthsFinder and its evolution. It was developed over 30 years of research by a man by the name of Don Clifton. Clifton went out and interviewed thousands of individuals, and what he was really trying to figure out is, are there some consistent themes of talent among the world's greatest leaders, people who are exceptional in their field? Doesn't matter what discipline. They could have been the most exceptional CEO of a Fortune 500 company or the most exceptional groundskeeper at a public garden. Were there consistent themes of talent? And what he found throughout his research is that people lead in different ways. There really were not consistent traits. And so using his research, there was an assessment developed called the Clifton Strengths Finder. And it's based upon a positive psychology theory. Okay, we're gonna try this again. Okay, we'll just use the old-fashioned way here. Okay, what the Clifton Strengths Finder does is it identifies your top talents. Don Clifton started grouping these different talents. He started out with over 800 different themes of talent, and he started grouping different talents together that were similar, and he whittled it down through that process to 34 different themes of talent that are identified through the Clifton Strengths Finder. And when you take that assessment, the results that you get, for those of you who have already gone through that process, are your top five themes of talent. Talents are natural, innate, inborn patterns of thought, feeling, behavior. They're there from the time that you were born. If you want to know the science behind it, when you are born, there are synapses in your brain that influence those thoughts, those feelings, those behaviors. And it's kind of the use it or lose it syndrome based upon the different experiences that you have in childhood. Some of those synapses will solidify and others will fall by the wayside. By the time you reach adulthood, the ones that are solid. They're there, they don't really change. And that's what forms those natural inborn patterns of thoughts, feeling, and behavior. So we are who we are by the time that we reach adulthood. As how that relates to the Clifton Strengths Finder, your top 10 talents are stable by the time you reach adulthood. However, they may reorder themselves. One of the questions I often get is, if I'm going to take this again, will I see different results? You might, because those talents might reorder themselves based upon what's going on in your life. So, and we'll talk about that a little bit more here momentarily. So you have these inborn talents. So what is that relationship to strength? Well, when you take that talent, and throughout your lifetime, you know that that's a talent, and so you add knowledge to it, and you add those experiences and skills to it, that is what develops it into a strength. And that strength is that best opportunity for near-perfect performance. If we think about it, we're a pretty pessimistic society. We have a tendency to really focus on our weaknesses. If you think about it growing up and bringing home that report card, what were the grades that mom and dad concentrated on the most? Was it the A's and B's, or was it the C's, D's, and F's? Okay, you need to improve those C's, D's, and F's, right? Well, I'm a parent, and I have to say that oftentimes that's kind of where my tendency is to go as well. But at the same time, we should be celebrating those successes as well, those natural talents, because those natural talents are our greatest opportunities to achieve near perfect performance. Now, that doesn't mean that you can let those weaknesses fall by the wayside. How many of you in here, for example, know a class that it's just not your strong point? Might be chemistry, might be English. You can work hard at that class. You've got to achieve that level of acceptable performance because it's not going away from your degree sheet, is it? No. So you have to work to reach that level of acceptable performance. But no matter how hard you work, it's probably never going to be that strength. It's never going to be that thing that comes naturally to you, that thing that gives you energy where you say, yes, I want to get up at 7 a.m. and go to that class every single day. Please. But those things that are natural to you, those are the things where you wouldn't mind that 7 a.m. class. So that's the difference between that natural talent and that strength. That talent that you have, if you feed it with knowledge and skill, it becomes that strength, and then you can apply it in your future. So let's see. You only get your top five when you take the Clifton Strengths Finder, but you do have a handout that came around that is the quick reference. It's a 1 to 2 sentence description of all of the 34 different themes of talent. I'm going to give you permission to claim a number 6 or number 7 if you would like, because you can probably go through that handout and go, ooh, this one didn't show up in my top 5, but I know that's me too. Give you an example. I told you your top 10 are pretty stable by the time you reach adulthood. The first time I took the Clifton Strengths Finder, my top 5 talents, responsibility, focus, achiever, belief, and relator, I was shocked. Discipline was not in my top 5. And anyone who knows me knows that I am a person of routine and structure. I get ready for work in the same way every morning. I get up, I work out, I eat breakfast, take my shower, iron my clothes, out the door. Same order every single morning. I even have the same order on Saturdays, except I sleep a little bit later. Routine and structure, discipline, that's me. But it wasn't in my top 5. Well, I went to training, and when you go to training, you get to see your whole list of 34. Guess what number 6 was? It was discipline. Fast forward a few years, I had to retake the Strengths Finder as I started my PhD program. Guess what? Focus wasn't in my top 5 anymore. Neither was relator. Does that mean I don't have focus and relator anymore? No. What was in my top 5? Discipline and learner. Well, that makes sense. I'm a working mom of 2 kids that just started back to school. I have to have that discipline. I'm feeding my learner. That's why they floated up in the top 5. Does that mean I don't have focus anymore? No, because again, anyone who knows me knows I have crazy focus. Mark Pogue, he's an alum of the Spears School of Business. He and I have become friends through this process, and Mark will tell you I have crazy focus. When my kids are arguing, 9 times out of 10, I don't hear them because I'm too intent on what it is that I'm working on. Both an advantage and not an advantage sometimes as a mom, okay? So again, based upon what's going on in your life, you may see that top 10 reorder themselves. Realize as well that no two people live out their talents in the same way. Just because you have a talent and someone else you know has the same talent doesn't mean that how you live them out is exactly alike. Your talents work in combination with each other. It's kind of like the Reese's peanut butter cup. What makes the Reese's peanut butter cup?
Chocolate and peanut butter.
Chocolate and peanut butter, right. If you just have the chocolate, is it a Reese's? No. If you just have the peanut butter, is it a Reese's? No. You have to have the two together, right? Well, your talents are the same way. They work together to make you live out who you are as an individual. I'll give you an example. How many of you have harmony? Anybody in here have harmony in their top five? Okay. Kelsey, tell us what harmony is like.
Harmony is where you want everybody to get along and be kind of even keel, like you don't like a lot of confrontation or arguments in between either your group or the people that you're working with or whatever setting that you're in.
Right, right. So whenever I think harmony, I'm a visual person, when I think about harmony, I think about unicorns and butterflies and rainbows, it's all nice and pretty and flowers and so forth, right? Well, for some people, yes, that could be a visual image of harmony. But I will also tell you that I live with harmony. And my husband knows I use him as examples quite a bit. He has harmony in his top five. And I will be honest with you, the first time he took the StrengthsFinder and got those results, I said, Jeff, we have been together for 20 years. You do not have harmony in your top five. You're retaking this thing. And he did. He retook it. And guess what came up in his top five again? Harmony. And so that forced me as a facilitator to step back and say, how does he live out his harmony? And so I got to looking at his other talents. He also has command in his top five. And so the harmony and command come together, and I jokingly refer to his harmony as drill sergeant harmony. So I mentioned that sometimes our kids fight. We have a 15-year-old daughter and a 10-year-old son. Brothers and sisters oftentimes argue. I tune them out because I'm high in focus. He, on the other hand, is right there in the middle, and he's putting an end to it. That is his harmony. He hates conflict, and because he also has command, he wants to put an end to conflict right then and there. Drill sergeant harmony. It's not unicorns and butterflies and rainbows. So everyone lives out their talents in different ways based upon the ways those different talents interact. Talents should be both developed and managed. Talents are a very positive thing. It gives you a language to communicate to others, this is what I can contribute, and this is what I need. For every bright part of a talent, the ability to be a mediator if you have harmony, the ability to take that personal responsibility for something, personal ownership if you're high in responsibility, those are very positive things. But for every positive aspect, I will tell you that every talent also has a shadow side to it. Many times in my life, responsibility is my number one. Many times in my life, I find myself going, darn that responsibility, because I just can't say no to things. So I tend to take on too much. Those are oftentimes what other individuals tend to focus on with our talents. Because like I said, we tend to be a pretty pessimistic society. But what I like about the StrengthsFinder is that it gives us a language to communicate to others. You know, while that may be the case, I'm working to manage that, and here's what I can contribute because I have that particular talent. So realize that you need to be aware of the shadow sides, like tuning out your children if you're high in focus, and figure out when, ooh, you know, now I see that it's elevating. I may need to step in as a mom, okay? Control those particular talents and what those shadow sides are. So let's talk some other facts about strengths. So talents can be applied and strengths can be applied in a variety of different ways. They can be applied in your academic life. They can be applied in your relationships with other people. They can be applied in your careers. And we're going to talk about all of those today, just briefly. So strengths in academics. How do your strengths relate to your academics? What are your roles and responsibilities as a successful student? Someone tell me what you're responsible for to be a successful student.
Get to class.
Getting to class on time.
Get the top grade. grades.
Mm-hmm. Getting the top grades, and how do we get the top grades?
By focusing on the subject and knowing the subject matter.
Knowing the subject matter, studying, right? Well, what are the implications of your talents for study? How can you use your talents for study? So, how many of you have empathy in the top five? Anyone have empathy in the room? Okay, if you don't have empathy in the room, I would encourage you to find a friend that has empathy. One of the things that research has shown about empathy in academics is that people who are high in empathy are great note takers because they can sense by the movement of a professor, by the fluctuation of their voice, what's important to write down and what's not important to write down. So find a friend that has empathy.
When you're talking about empathy, is that basically linked to emotional intelligence?
You could, yes. Yes, empathy is linked to emotional intelligence. So if you look, for those of you that have taken the Strengths Finder, or even if you, once you take the Clifton Strengths Finder, you will have access to a website that has a lot of information on it. I would encourage you to spend some time exploring that website. One of the tabs on the website is the online book. And the online book provides information of how the StrengthsFinder, bless you, correlates to different assessments that are out there. For example, and different theories that are out there as well. For example, Holland's Person, Environment, Career Development Theory, the MBTI, Myers-Briggs Assessment. So it's got information in it about how those different things correlate. That's a really good question. Let me tell you how I see the talents playing out in my life as a student. I mentioned I'm a part-time PhD student. Focus, again, in my top five. What that means for me when I'm studying is that I can focus for long periods of time on the same subject as I'm studying, and I need to be in a quiet space with no distractions that allows me to focus. That's my happy point as a student. Not every student's like that, though. I work with a lot of students. Part of another hat that I wear in my role is I work with some of our students that are students at risk, students that have been suspended and readmitted. They've had academic challenges. What I have found among those students is that a lot of them are high in adaptability, meaning that for them, focusing for long periods of time is going to be misery. So how do we promote their academic success? One of the strategies that they use is that they rotate subject matter and they study in 20 to 30 minute chunks. I'm going to study for 20 to 30 minutes on this topic. I'm going to switch to something else, study for 20 to 30 minutes. I'm going to give myself permission to take a 10 minute break and then I'm going to come back. That variety feeds their adaptability, their need for adaptability. So I would encourage you to look at your strengths and think about how do they play into you being a successful student, because we all know that being a successful student is part of that foundation for being successful as you secure that opportunity in your future. Okay, it looks like we're dead overall. There we go, got it to advance. All right, let's talk about career success then. So the Gallup organization, most of us are familiar with Gallup based upon political polls, the polling office, but they also have the higher education division, and the higher education division is the organization that actually leads the StrengthsQuests, StrengthsFinder effort. And so they've done some research on strengths and career success, strengths and well-being, and what the correlations are. And what they have found is that individuals who have the opportunity in their job to really focus in on their strengths and apply those talents and strengths every day in their career are more satisfied in their position. And if they're more satisfied, then they're more successful. And what happens when you're more successful on the job? Well, you earn a higher income as well because you're performing better. And so that's kind of the basic career relationship about strengths, but also how strengths plays into career success is having that focus on your natural talents and on strengths development also increases your sense of well-being. And so individuals who have that strengths focus and they work within organizations that allow them to have that strengths focus and really promote that strengths focus also show fewer sick days, there are fewer lost time accidents on the job, and so it's a pretty important deal to really be able to focus on that strengths development as an employee and within your career. So you have an announcement in front of you, and we're going to talk about the career process in three different ways. We're going to talk about it from the career choice perspective, we're going to talk about it from the career search perspective, and then we'll also talk about it from the relationship perspective in the workplace. You have a position description in front of you, and what I'd like for you to do is take just a minute. This is a description that I pulled off of the OSU Hire system this morning. Take just a minute and look at that position and tell me how you would apply your talents or what talents you think would apply to that particular position. I've got it up here. It's pretty small, so I don't know if you can read it on the slide, which is why I gave you a hard copy. But take a look at that and tell me what keywords you see that might help you identify what type of talents would appeal to this particular position. If you haven't yet taken your Strengths Finder, you've got that handout that's the brief, the quick reference with the brief description, so you can use that as a reference as well. You can speak up at any time. What are some key words that might stick out to you?
In my mind, so one of my strengths is move. I think it fits me perfectly, and I love how that's going to fit with relationship builders.
Right. I was sitting down in my office using my yellow highlighter to highlight some keywords, and a lot of the keywords that I highlighted were keywords related to relationship building. So if you have talents like relator, communication, woo, developer, those are some talents that this type of position is going to feed. Mm-hmm. What are some others?
Achiever.
The language, again, as I was highlighting specific words, keywords, the language is very goal-oriented. It talks about achieving things, setting goals, working towards goals, accomplishing. Again, those are some very goal-oriented type, that's a very goal-oriented type of orientation. So some talents that might appeal to that, or that you might be able to apply to that aspect of this position, are things like achiever, and focus, and discipline, strategy for setting, if you're strategic, for setting goals, okay? This is an example of how you can use the Strengths Finder as you are looking at different opportunities. You know, you can think about, as you're reading different position descriptions, how would I use my talents in that particular job? Where would I have the chance to feed who I am, those natural talents, those strengths, if I were performing these job responsibilities? And if the answer to that question is, oh, I could see how this talent would apply here, and this one, oh, I could use it this way, or this would feed this other talent that I have, then that would be a position that is probably going to be very satisfying to you as an individual, which means, again, you're going to perform better and you're likely to earn a higher income. However, if your response is, well, I don't really see how my talents apply, or, you know what, this would drive my blank talent, whatever it is, crazy. It would really drag me down. Well, then that's an opportunity that you may want to pass on and look at something else that's a better fit. So using those, what I call strengths-based glasses, to read those position descriptions can give you a better idea of what are the types of positions you're going to be more satisfied and successful in versus those that you may struggle a little bit to be successful in. Questions about that? No? Okay, let's talk about the career search. So as you're actually looking for opportunities, looking for that internship or looking for that full-time job, then how do you apply your strengths to that particular area? What type of process? It could be the process, the schedule that you set up for yourself, the tracking system that you create. How are your talents going to influence that?
I want you to take just a moment and think about your working style. What are your top five, and how does that describe your working style? And how does that working style influence how you apply that to your job search, looking for that internship or that full-time job? What do you think? Let me give you an example. Again, my top five: responsibility, focus, achiever, belief, and relator. Discipline, a close six, or up in the top, that top five, you could say, depending upon time I'm taking the assessment. For me, if I were looking for a job, what would that mean? It means I'm probably going to be more comfortable and more successful in my search if I set up a routine for myself. So I know that every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, I have blocked off 2 hours consistently to focus on my job search. That's my routine. And I may even have it scheduled to Monday, I'm looking for new leads. Wednesdays, I'm putting together new applications. And Fridays, I'm following up. That's structure. That's my comfortable space. Now contrast that with someone who doesn't thrive on that routine and structure and focus. What might that look like? For someone who's high in adaptability, it might mean, you know what, I'm going to take it week by week. And every week might be a different structure. I'm going to set time aside, but I'm going to evaluate on Sunday night when my time is for that next week. Okay? I'll get to it, but it's going to look a little bit different. And I may be doing something, you know, I may have a 30-minute chunk here and an hour chunk there, and I might be focusing on different activities during those time frames. My tracking system, how I keep track of my applications, may be different than that person who's very disciplined and structured and goal-oriented. So think about how your strengths come into play with how you look for jobs. If you're high in communication types of talents, if you're a communication, you're a woo, you may spend more time looking for leads by talking to someone, as opposed to someone who's high in input, who might spend more time online, using online resources to look for different leads. That can be both a pro and a con. It can be really successful. It can also have that shadow side. You don't want to overlook opportunities. So you've got to think about how your talents influence how you look for jobs. And then as you are seeking out those opportunities, you're developing those documents, you're practicing for your interviews, how can your talents be of benefit? Well, they provide a great language for you to explain to individuals what you can bring to the table innately as a candidate. Now, that doesn't mean you step into an interview and you say, "Hi, I'm Amy Gasway. I'm responsibility, focus, achiever, belief, and relator," because they may not know what that means. But I have the language through the descriptions to say, I'm an individual that takes personal ownership of what it is that I take on my plate. There's responsibility, a description of responsibility. I am a get-it-done person. I put my foot down and go full steam ahead to get a job accomplished whenever I say that I'm going to do something. My word is my bond. That's my achiever and my focus. So read through not just those little descriptions, but I encourage you when you get your results, read through your signature theme report, which gives you a whole paragraph description of your different themes. It will give you some language you can use in your cover letters, in your interview process, to explain how you can contribute to different organizations. Questions about that? No? Okay. Next up, relationships. Guess what? You get out there in the real world and you're going to have to work with people. Yay! But what if you're not that person who's high in woo or communication? Maybe you're not that people person. It's okay. Your strengths can give you clues as to how you relate to others, what you need from other people, and then it can also give you clues, strengths in general, can give you clues as to how to read other people and know what they need from you as well. Or what is the source of some of those causes of frustration that you may encounter in the workplace. Or really, even as a student, when you're working on group projects or you're communicating with a faculty member, it goes to relationships across the board. And so let's talk about strengths and relationships. It can give you an idea of what you expect from other people and what your needs are. For example, so Kelsey and I used to work in the same office, and Kelsey will tell you that because of my discipline and my focus and achiever, I am a person that likes to have an agenda for a meeting. I like to have it in advance so I can think about things ahead of time before I go into a meeting, and that way I'm better able to contribute in a meeting. I am not a fly by the seat of your pants kind of gal, which is evident by the fact that I have notes over here. Okay. That's my comfort zone. I haven't always worked with individuals who need that same thing. And so being able to communicate with them that right now in our office, there's three coordinators. We have a weekly staff meeting, and we are in a rotation of who leads the staff meeting. We know that whenever it's my turn, we're going to have an agenda. But it's also important for me to communicate with our other coordinators when it's their turn to say, hey, could we get an agenda put together for this week so I can think about what we're talking about? It gives me a language to communicate what my needs are. And they also know what my expectations are of them as a coworker, that because of what my talents are, follow through, loyalty, those are things that are going to be really important to me as an individual. It also gives you clues as to what others' expectations are of you. So for example, I used to have a coworker, another coordinator in our office, that was very high in adaptability. Adaptability, I will tell you, is at the bottom of my list. So your top 10 are pretty stable by adulthood. Your bottom 10 are also pretty stable. Adaptability is definitely in my bottom 10. I am not a person that's, a fly by the seat of the pants type of a gal. But this other individual that I worked with, that was one of her strengths. In her top five was adaptability. And we actually made a really good team because I would plan things out. If you need an agenda made, or if you need somebody to do a to-do list, if you need someone to outline a process, I'm your gal. But at the same time, when things don't go as planned, she was the right person to talk me off the ledge because it was stressing me out. And then she could come up with another direction, just like that. So that speaks to why employers oftentimes look for diversity in the hiring process. A lot of times when we talk about diversity in the hiring process, we tend to focus on racial diversity, ethnic diversity. But when employers are looking at diversity in the hiring process, they're also looking at different ways of thinking. And StrengthsQuests is a good tool to figure out what those different ways of thinking are. It adds a lot of value to the workplace. So what's the definition of insanity, the common definition of insanity? Someone tell me.
Doing something over and over again. When it's like not having a benefit.
Right, doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results, right? Well, if you're in a workplace and the employer working and hiring individuals has hired people who all think alike, they've all got the same top five talents, even though they may live those talents out a little bit differently, a problem arises, what's gonna happen? You're going to get the same set of solutions. Your array of different options to choose from is going to be pretty limited. But if you have individuals that think differently, they have different talents, they're bringing different options to the table. It's a much more rich problem-solving type of environment. And so StrengthsQuests gives you the language to know what your expectations and needs are, but also to analyze the expectations and needs of other people. And while sometimes those differences may cause a little bit of conflict and frustration, it also gives you the insight to appreciate what those other individuals bring to the table. The fact that if you're a stressor like me because of your talents, and that's a shadow side, that there are other people with different talents who don't stress. And you can depend upon them to help talk you out of your stress. Or when you're experiencing conflict as a manager, to be able to step back and say, have I really given this employee that I'm managing things that appeal to their talents? Or the tasks that I'm assigning to them, are those things that don't come naturally to them, that are really in conflict with who they are as an individual? And is there another person on our team that might better serve in that function? Or for you to step back and reflect and say, you know what, something just doesn't feel right here in this situation. Why? What talent of mine is not being fed? What's wrong with this picture? And to go, oh, okay, in all of those situations, based upon my talents, what's within my power to impact that situation and make it better? So that's how you can use strengths in a relationship type of setting. So as you can see, there's all different ways of applying your top five natural talents to your career. Whether that's creating that academic foundation, being successful academically, so that you can have that strong qualification to enter the career of your choice, or whether it's deciding what that career choice might be that fits with who you are as an individual, or whether it's using the language of strengths to communicate those talents to a potential employer and how you can contribute so to be successful or to organize that job search, or building relationships and being productive actually in the job as well. So lots of different applications there. With that, I'm gonna open it up to questions and see what else you all might wanna know about strengths. What questions do you have that I can answer to help you be more successful? Yeah.
So someone who is has adaptability as their number one, wouldn't their strengths be adaptable as well?
Ooh, that's a good question. I'm going to say no, because you need to realize, you know, going back to the science of strengths, they're formed by those synapses in your brain, and so those synapses don't change. They're solidified by the time you reach adulthood, and those are brain structures. Now, if there was some kind of traumatic brain injury, some type of physical injury that, or I would suppose, not being a physician myself, you know, maybe a chemical type of impact or something on those synapses that weakened them, then I would say, yes, they may change. But otherwise, from a physical, scientific standpoint, no, they don't. But that is a really good question. I've never really thought about that. What other questions do you have?
Online, is there a clear way to figure out what are the shadow sides to each of the roles?
So on that website that I mentioned earlier that you all have access to with your StrengthsQuest code, yes, they call them barrier labels. And so look for information on barrier labels. There are a number of different tabs that are on that side where you can get more information. You'll find research on strengths there. There's a really helpful tab, I think it's the fourth one over, it's the apply tab, and it gives you student action items and professional action items. So what it does for each of your top five strengths, it gives you a list of different things to think about related to either your life as a student or your life as a current professional or future professional. And so I would encourage you definitely to look at those. But yes, barrier labels. Under the resources and research tab, you'll find some information on barrier labels. You're welcome. What other questions do you have? Well, thank you for your attention, and thank you for the opportunity to come and visit with you about strengths. I'll hang around for a little bit, so if you want to talk one-on-one and ask questions, you're free to do that as well. Again, thank you.